Give some correction. Professor Lisa will tell us about copyright. There is a correction, so let it be modified. All the participants should note that Professor Lisa will deliver the lecture on copyright law for the academic institutions. Thank you, ma'am. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you so much, sir. Respected Dr. B.S. Foti, Director GIPS, respected Dr. Anil Kumar Ghosh, and the coordinators of this program, and all respected participants. At the outset, let me congratulate Vidyaragnan International Business School for organizing such a wonderful faculty development program, which is extending for a fortnight on such a relevant topic, teaching, learning, and research methodology. It's my privilege to be here and to share my views on copyright law and academic institutions. Without wasting much time, I directly go to my slides because there are so many issues and problems that we need to take care of. So the scheme of my presentation will be, I will be talking about generally IPRs and what is needed to protect and enforce IPRs, and especially copyright, which is the most important intellectual property right when we are in the academic field. We may be researchers, we may be teachers and faculties, or we may be students, but copyright is a kind of intellectual property that should be respected and that should be known very closely by all persons who are working in academic field. What are the objectives of copyright law? What are the prerequisites? What are the rights copyright confers? What is the concept of fair use? And especially what is meant by copyright vis-a-vis academic institutions? And may I know whether I am properly audible? Participants, you can show me thumbs up if I am audible to you. Okay, thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. Yeah, so look at this slide. So this slide captures the various dimensions of intellectual property rights. What are the various candidates? Am I audible again? I hope I am audible. If I am not audible, you can just indicate by raising your hand. You can indicate so that I will understand that I am not audible. Okay. So you can see. Yeah. So you can see that IPR is such a big concept, which has got in it the intellectual property types like patent, trademark, copyright, geographical indication, integrated circuits, trade secrets, and there is plan variety protection. That's why you are also seeing plan breeders rights, plan variety protection, and utility model protection. Of course, utility model is something which is not being protected in India, but there are more than 125 countries wherein even utility patents are being protected. When we speak in Indian perspective, we give emphasis on patents, trademark, copyrights, trade secret, geographical indication, industrial designs like that. Now, when specifically we come to the realm of copyright law, what is the objective of protecting copyright? Why we are bothered about copyright? Why in this FDP, there is a topic dedicated on copyright? What importance and significance it assumes? So this we can find when we analyze various theories attached to copyright. So this also will give us the rationale and justification for protecting copyright. The first theory that I would like to address is human right theory. I'm not sure whether you all are from a field of law or we are having some teachers from other discipline, but anyway, now everything is cross-discipline, interdisciplinary, and multidisciplinary. So the teachers of law should know the basic principles from other disciplines and vice versa. So human right is a concept that everybody, even a child, knows. So Universal Declaration of Human Rights and International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. All these important human rights documents talk about protection of copyright. And they say that once you create a copyright in the form of a book, in the form of a literary or artistic work, it is the fundamental human right that you have a right of protection. Your work, your creativity should be protected. And when we move on to the welfare theory, there should be dissemination of knowledge. The welfare theory is framed in the perspective of the public, we the public. So you are here to know about copyright from me. I have created these slides. So you have a right to know the new information. If there is no dissemination of knowledge, how our knowledge will be enhanced? So the books are written, films are created, musics are composed for the purpose of sharing to the public. And it is our right, as a human right also I can explain, the right of entertainment, the right of information, the right to get a new knowledge, the right to get a new technology. This is very much needed for welfare. So the welfare theory also supports the protection of copyright, because if copyright protection is not there, authors will not be sharing their work with the people. Films will not be casted, music will not be shared there, because you know that the moment you upload something, there can be piracy and you will not get any economic benefit or you will not get any recognition. So it's only when a system of copyright exists, the authors and creators will share their work, then only the public right of being informed, getting the knowledge, getting the information can be satisfied. Fairness theory, it is from the angle of authors, the persons who create. So it is fair that authors' rights should be protected. It's fair that the society devises a system wherein the creator's creativity is respected, creator's creativity is protected. Personality theory. When an author creates something in the form of a novel, in the form of a book, in the form of a film, actually what he transfers into the work is nothing but his personality. So when you read the works of Shakespeare, when you read the works of Wordsworth, you can see that you can see their personality as well. When you talk about literature, there are many PhDs being conducted on the personality of the person through their works. So when you read tragedies, you can see that, of course, the one side of the creator's personality is being told there. Culture theory. So we have a lot many monuments. The monument should be protected. The films, the literature, the music, any piece of entertainment, any piece of creativity that we make, it becomes part of the culture of the country. So it's very important for the society and for the country that in order to develop a good culture, there should be protection of copyright. Then only creators will keep on creating and investors will keep on investing. When I say investors, I am not talking only about patents. The person who invests in buildings, all these things we can consider, because even you have a copyright on the very design of the building. So this all become part of our culture. So when we look at the copyright from the culture's perspective also, it's very important that there should be protection for copyright. And lastly, the economic theory. When you create something, suppose I am an author and I write a book, not only I get the recognition as an author, but I get my royalty. The film producers and directors, they get their return. Film actors, they get their return. So this all add to the economic development. When you get more money, of course, you will pay more tax to the government. And of course, the country's economic status will be growing. So I have pointed out 6 theories on this slide, but there are many more theories that you can find out when you read more about this. But in this class, I feel that the discussion about this 6 theory will be sufficient to give you a fair understanding of the importance of copyright from the public perspective, from the author's perspective, and from the country's perspective. Now, when we talk about the characteristics and nature of copyright, it's an automatic protection. In order to get a patent, you need to go to patent office and register it. But the moment you create something, you have the copyright without going to the copyright office. So this is my first slide. You see what I have written here? I have a C symbol, encircled C. This is the copyright symbol. See, Professor L.P. Lucas, 2021. That means from 2021, I am, from this year, I am claiming copyright for the slides that I have created because I have prepared all these slides by reading so many things. So this is a piece of academic creativity that I have done. So I have copyright here. I didn't go and register this PPT with the copyright office. There is no need. The moment I created, I have a copyright. So I have written almost the slides about my copyright. So you can claim your copyright the moment you write a poem, or the moment you recite something, the moment you sing a song, the moment you write a book, even if it is not published yet, still you have a copyright. So this is automatic protection. Degree of creativity is very less. So you will be just jotting down something on your piece of paper. For somebody else, it may not be having any creative value. But still, if the work is not of very great value, the idea is not very great, someone may say it is a stupid work, it is a foolish work, but still it has got a copyright. Because in copyright law, we are not bothered about academic credits. We are not bothered about its scholarship. We are not bothered about its literary merits. So the degree of originality, the degree of creativity, everything is very minimal when we talk about copyright. So when you write a personal letter to your friend, when you write a mail to your friend and sending it is an email, do you know that even that email has a copyright? So I think this example will be sufficient for you to understand the point. The degree of creativity is very less in the copyright. And copyright is there not for ideas, but only for expression. There is a famous case, R.G. Anand versus D.L.X. Filling, wherein the basic principles of copyrights are being discussed. So I will tell you an example. You have a very good story in your mind. So you are sharing that particular storyline to your friend. And the friend is, your best friend is also impressed in this story. And he has a certain creativity. So, and he writes the story. He writes the story and he publishes in his name. You cannot claim that there is a copyright infringement because the story was only in idea form when you have told him. You haven't written down the story anywhere. You have just told verbally. And he is the person who wrote the story first, who gave a proper shape to the story first, because he expressed that idea in the form of letters on a piece of paper. Or he expressed the idea in the form of typewritten letters in the computer. Anywhere, any fixation, in any form that he has done. So that's why I said to you, when it is in the idea form, it is in the abstract form, there is no protection. But only when it is expressed, or you have recorded it somewhere, you have written it somewhere, you have typed it somewhere, you have drawn it somewhere, then only the copyright law comes into picture. And copyright is a concept which is a bundle of rights. For example, you have written a book, and if somebody is publishing that book in your name, of course your right is affected. There is a violation of copyright. Already you have written and somebody else is publishing. And somebody is taking a chapter from the book and photocopying it and distributing to others. There is a copyright violation. And now some smart guy is converting the book into audio form and start selling it in the pen drive. Yes, there is a copyright violation. You have written your book in Hindi and your friend has translated it in English without taking your permission. There is a copyright violation. So all these rights are associated with the copyrights. So that's why we say copyright is a bundle of rights. And more interestingly, it is a statutory right. Though I said that copyright protection is available even without a formal registration, but you have a Copyright Act 1957. So since the coming into force of the Copyright Act 1957, there is no right in common law, but only right in as per the statute, the right as per the statute. So that's why we call it a statutory right. and copyright will be existing there for lifetime of the author plus 60 years. So the copyright in the slides that I have created, in the PPT that I have created, I can claim only during my lifetime and 60 years. It is not a perpetual right. But copyright law has got two aspects, economic right and moral right. I have written in this slide that moral right is perpetual. This I will be explaining in the next slide. And it is also territorial. So being an Indian, I write a work in India and there is an automatic protection, and alternatively I can go to copyright office and I can register it also. But the right is territorial. I cannot go to Pakistan and enforce this right. I cannot go to Germany and enforce this right, because under Indian Copyright Act 1957, I am getting this right. So the right is territorial. And it is not an absolute right. So I saw somebody is clicking photo of my slide, and I am seeing that somebody is writing notes from my slide. All these are fair use. You are entitled to write notes from the slides, because you will say that you have done it for academic purpose. You have done it as part of your private study and research. Yes, that is permitted under Section 52 of the Copyright Act, which technically we call as fair use. Legally, in the copyright terminology, we use it as fair use or fair dealing. And I am sure that most of you are aware of the case, the Chancellor, Masters and Scholars of the University of Oxford versus Rameshri Photocopy Service case, wherein the students were photocopying the books of various publishers, including Oxford, Cambridge, etc. So the publishers went to court and say that there is cover to cover photocopying that is going on in the photocopy service of the university, and that is violation of our copyright. As a copyright teacher, I tell you, yes, it is a violation of the copyright. But still the court said that when it is done for the purpose of education, there is no copyright limitation. There is no copyright infringement. Of course, I have reservations to this judgment, but still I have brought this case to you to tell you how liberal and generous even the judiciary is in interpreting the fair use clauses for students and for academicians. Because India, being a developing country wherein education is not free, wherein scholarship for all the students are not available, and books are available only at high rates. So when you talk about the reference books from Oxford and Cambridge, etc. So we cannot afford that books. The students cannot afford that books because the book costs 10,000, 12,000 rupees. So who can afford all these books? So then the court says that if they have done photocopying of the books, or they kept on clicking photos of the book in their mobile, in the course of their education, from the moment they have taken admission until they complete their exam, all these things are covered under the fair use. Of course, this is a judgment from the Delhi High Court. The Supreme Court did not hear the matter because the appeal was filed, then it was withdrawn. So we do not know what the apex court says on it. If the matter had gone to the Supreme Court, what would have been the decision? We don't know. But this is what the High Court said. Delhi High Court said the fair use is a very, very liberal concept. And though you have a copyright, of course, there is no monopoly. There can be compulsory licenses. I know that especially in the patent perspective, the compulsory licenses is the buzzword now, because the COVID vaccine, the medicines and the vaccines for COVID, every day in the newspaper we read, and every day in the various news channels we hear that various NGOs and associations are talking about granting compulsory licenses to medicines. And likewise, the compulsory licensing concept is very much available in copyright law. Suppose there is a book and the copies of the books are not available, or it is out of print and the academic community feels that the book is very important, you can apply for a compulsory licensing. So likewise, exceptions and limitations are also there in the realm of copyright law. So when legally we approach the subject, copyright section 30 defines the subject matter of copyright. And for your convenience, I say that when we look at section 30, it is original, literary, dramatic, musical, and artistic work. And I will explain what is the concept of originality. Original means it has come from the author. That's it. You haven't copied it from your friend. You haven't copied it from any book. you haven't copied it from any article. It has come from you. That's it. So that's why when I said if you are writing a letter to your friend, it is your copyright. You go to your university and clicking a photograph of the university, or you are clicking photo of Akshardham, you are clicking photo of Taj Mahal, you become the owner of the copyright because it is what you have done. But suppose if I have written a poem and you are copying my poem, your colleague has written an article and you have copied your colleague's article, all this become copyright infringement. But if it has come from you, you have written, you have created, you have taken the photo, then it is original. It is as simple. So then there is a concept of derivative work, sound recording and cinematographic filling. I have already prepared this class and I believe that it is being recorded. If the talk is being recorded, then you can say that it is a sound recording. You are recording music, it is sound recording. Cinematographic filling, if the class is being shooted or any videos that you say, it is derivative work. So original literary, dramatic, musical and artistic work and cinematic film and sound recording are the things wherein copyright available. And I think for academic institute, all this is important because in most of the institute, you have your film clubs, you have your music clubs, so you have your debates clubs. So nothing can be discarded. For us, everything is important, whether it is sound recording, cinematographic film, or whether it is original literary, dramatic, musical and artistic work in an institution, in an academic institution, we are concerned about all these aspects. So now coming back to the previous slides, books, articles, personal letters, photos, lyrics, music, filling, painting and whatnot. In everything you have a copyright. But as I told you, if I am taking this class without a PPT, extempore I am speaking, spontaneous I am speaking. Of course, there is no fixation. So the copyright protection can be given only to the copyrightable subject matter as per section 13. I have just shown you what is section 13, original literary, dramatic, musical and artistic work, cinematography, film and sound recording. So now I will give an example of AI, artificial intelligence. It is nowhere mentioned in section 13, so you will not get a copyright. Unless and until the Indian Parliament incorporates a subject into the Copyright Act, there will be no protection. That's why I told you earlier, copyright is a statutory protection. And there is a statutory recognizable subject matter under section 13. All items that are covered under section 13 only will get copyright protection. Now you may ask, there is copyright protection for database, there is copyright protection for computer program, but why this is not mentioned in this slide when I talk about section 13? The answer is, the definition of literary works includes database and computer programs. So in order to know the real scope of copyright, you have to see the independent definition of each and everything: literary, dramatic, musical, artistic works, cinematographic, film and sound recording. Since I don't have that much time, I haven't dealt with the independent definition. Those who are interested in the topic can open the Copyright Act. You can download it from Google also. Then you can start reading the definition. Then you can understand the real ambit of copyright protection. So you look at this. This is the copyright symbol encircled C. So when you write an article, I will always advise you that you claim your copyright. By putting the symbol, you claim your copyright, as I have done in my PPT. You claim copyright. And even in CDs, pen drives, wherein you record your items, you have a copyright. It can be a sculpture, it can be a painting, it can be a statue, whatever, there is copyright. As I told you, there is a formality-free protection. If you have to protect a patent, it is not formality-free. You have to go to a patent office with a proper patent application form with the required fees. But here nothing is needed. The moment you created, the protection comes into existence. That's why I said it is automatic. But still, you have an option to go and register it in order to get more evidentiary value, because you get a certificate in your name. Then if there is a case of infringement, you can only show, I have a certificate, copyright certificate in my name. So either it can be automatic or you may go to a copyright office and register it. India gives that facility. But for your information, I am telling you, there are countries wherein there is no registration of copyright also existing. Because since copyright is automatic protection, some countries are not giving any opportunity to register it. But in India, you have both the concept. You may register it additionally. There is a copyright office. E-registration can be done, like e-FDP programs that we are arranging now. You can just fill up the form and upload the things in the computer. You can visit the website of the Intellectual Property Office of India, the copyright division, and then you can upload your document. So an e-filing is also possible. It's very easy now. So as I told you, copyright comprises of moral right and economic right. I was talking about the bundle of rights when I said you have right of reproduction, you have right of translation, you have right of adaptation, you have right of distribution, you have the right to convert your copyright into something else, into a cinematographic film, sound recording, etc. This is economic right. Section 14 talks about a long list of economic rights. And section 57 talks about the moral right, which is very important for us, the academicians, because usually many people forget about this moral right. I told you in my previous slide, copyright is for a limited period and you have your time, only lifetime of the author plus 60 years. So when I referred to Shakespeare's and Words, Shelley's work, or Wordsworth's work as the case may be, they have died centuries before. They are no more with us. So the 60-year period time is also expired. So now you believe that there is no copyright in Shakespeare's work because years ago the person passed away. But the moral right in their work still exists. And what is this moral right? Right to be claimed as author. So you cannot take Shakespeare's work, which is not very famous also, because when we talk about Romeo and Juliet or Macbeth, everybody knows about it. But there can be some sonnets that he has written, which is not very famous. So if you are taking his sonnet and writing your name and publishing it, still there is an infringement, though 60 year plus lifetime is over, because the moral right, right to be claimed as the author, and right against mutilation, which we call as integrity right, this is existing for perpetual. I repeat, paternity right and integrity right are the two aspects of moral rights in copyright law, and there is no end to this right. Centuries, it will exist. Till the end of the world, the moral right will exist. So we should be very careful, even if it is a very old work, still it will have a moral right, though economic right in the work might have expired. I already have dealt with the section 14, so you can just read this slide. Right of reproduction, right of distribution, right of communication, translation. So I said economic rights, which the owners can claim, moral rights, which the authors can claim. So I will explain the difference between ownership and authorship. You have written an article and you have sent it to Indian Law Institute. You know, Journal of Indian Law Institute is very famous in India. So you sent that article to the journal. And when ILA publishes that journal, ILA becomes owner of your article and you become the author of your article. You write a book and you give it to LexisNexis to publish. When LexisNexis publishes the work, LexisNexis becomes the owner who has the economic right under section 14, and you only become the author. So I hope you understood the difference between economic rights for the owners and other others' rights, the moral rights for the others. And I will tell you a third situation. Now, there are a lot of self-publishers, because in the computer itself, you can type everything and you can online publish it. So what is the need of going to a publisher? Because the publisher will only give you, say, 12% royalty or 20% royalty. So you feel that there is no need of convincing a publisher and getting your work published. So you will do self-publishing. So when you are doing it self-publication, you are a self-publishing person, then of course you are both owner plus author. So there can be situations wherein both authorship and ownership can be vested with the same person. In such a situation, he has both the economic rights and the moral rights. So this is the same. Section 17 talks about this first authorship and first ownership concept. So it may be the same person or it may be in different persons, as I explained to you. Now, publisher author relationship. And I quickly move to the concept of infringement, because infringement of copyright is not a joke. There can be even criminal punishment. A person can be imprisoned for infringement. So when there is an unauthorized exercise, so suppose you are clicking photos of all my slides and then you started creating your own slide, everything verbatim you are writing, and then you go to your class and you show them this PPT as if you have created it. Okay, so every slide in its order you are giving, and instead of my name, you have written your name, XYZ. It is an unauthorized copying of my work. So you have taken a chapter from a particular book, and the majority of the portions from the main portions from the chapter you retained, you copied. Then two or three paragraphs here and there you have added. Then you are publishing it in your name. It is an unauthorized use of the previous book. So when you do such things, there will be punishment under Section 51. And Section 57, again, I am referring here because there can be situations wherein you mutilate a work, modify a work. As in the example that I have told you, you are copying a poem. There are four stanzas in a poem. Two stanzas you have taken and one more stanza you have added. Of course, it is a modification. There is a good photo of someone else. Priyanka Chopra's photo. So you are adding a mustache to that. All this is destruction and mutilation of the work. So with respect to painting, with respect to film, with respect to articles and books, any sort of mutilation and modification that you can imagine, the possible mutilations and modification, all this will affect the moral rights of the author. So Section 51 and 57 should be taken care of when we deal with infringement. And as I told you, when you talk about the patent law, of course, you may not have criminal remedies. But when we talk about copyright law, it invites both civil and criminal liabilities. There can be injunctions, damages, account of profit, and there can be criminal remedies. Okay, so I will explain the punishment here in this slide. When you have committed for the first time, 6 months imprisonment and 50,000 rupees. And in the subsequent offense, there is an enhanced punishment, 1 year imprisonment and 1 lakh rupees. So it may go up to 3 year imprisonment and 2 lakhs rupees. But I told you from the Rameshri photocopy case, when we are in the academic field, we have the excuse of fair dealing if it amply suits us. So when there is an allegation of copyright infringement, you have a lot many defenses. You listen carefully the first example that I am giving, independent work. So while explaining some slides, I told you the example of taking photo of Akshardham. You have gone and taken a photo of Akshardham, and your friend also goes there, and your friend is clicking a photo of Akshardham from the same direction from where you have taken it. So the photos are identical. In this situation, your work is an independent work. Though the photos are looking similar, photos are looking identical, both of you have independently created it. So when somebody says that, oh, this is an article which I have written, so if you have also written the same thing, you can, this is a hypothetical situation, so you can say that, no, I haven't copied your work. It is my independent creation. Because copyright law never believes in novelty. In patents, you have a novelty. But here, when I discussed about the prerequisites of copyright, I only told that there should be a work under Section 13, there should be some creativity, and there should be fixation. So when I gave you the example of taking photograph, it is a common thing and no hypothetical imagination is needed there when it happens. Okay, the same photos from same angle can be taken by so many people, and you cannot say that I have taken the first photo, so I only should have the copyright, no. So now after the class, I may tell you, okay, can you write down on a piece of paper what all you learned from my presentation? What are the things that you learned? Some people may have computer memory and they may write many things verbatim that I have taught them. And then can other person say that how you could write like this because I also wrote like this? Yes, that may happen. But both of you will have independent copyright on what you have written. Only you have to prove that it is original. You haven't copied from other one. You haven't copied from your friend. You haven't copied it from anywhere. That is the only thing. So the independent work created can be an excuse. Then work in public domain. As I told you, after 60 year plus lifetime of the author, you have to simply acknowledge only the work. These all works are in public domain. And there is a doctrine of substantiality. So 2-3 lines you have taken, some phrases you have taken, one paragraph you have taken, no one can say that there is copyright infringement. Because your portion, what you have copied, is insubstantial. But if you have taken a page together, a chapter together, and here and there so many paragraphs you have produced, then it is a substantial taking. And friends, but you please take a tip from me. Even if you are taking a particular sentence, I will advise you that you should give the source. It is for what? Because not only copyright infringement we are concerned about, we are also concerned about the plagiarism when we are in academic community. Copyright infringement and plagiarism are totally different things. The Copyright Act 1957 does not address the concept of plagiarism. Concept of plagiarism is a notion in the academic integrity discourse or intellectual honesty discussions. So even you have reproduced one sentence from a book, no one may sue you for copyright infringement. There can be an allegation against you for plagiarism. We do not have any statute dealing with the plagiarism. It's only certain uncodified norms, certain ethical conduct that every university has prepared for itself. But I would say that being in the academics and being a responsible academician, it is your duty to acknowledge the source from where you have taken it. What is the book? What is an article? Or whether you have taken it from the newspaper or if it is from website, please give the complete link of the website. Then no one can fire you. No one can allege that you have done some plagiarism. No one can allege that you have done a copyright infringement. So even if it is a sentence, please start practicing it, giving acknowledgement, putting the source. And see, you may listen to my class. You have taken only ideas from my class. Then you develop a slide your own. Then you start writing about it. Oh, why can't I write an article? It's a very interesting topic. So let me write an article and publish it in some journals. So I cannot stop you. Why you have written all this? I have told you these things in my class. No, I cannot do that because these are ideas that I have discussed it. Unless and until you have copied my slide as such verbatim, there is no copyright infringement. And there is no copyright for any ideas. That's why I gave you the example of you telling story to your friend and your smart friend for printing and selling the story. So I told your friend is having copyright infringement and he hasn't infringed anything. But of course, he has done a plagiarism, but there is no copyright infringement that he has done. Ideas can be plagiarized, but ideas can never be copyright infringed. I am repeating it. There is no copyright over ideas. So if somebody is copying the idea, there is no copyright infringement. But when we strictly speak about plagiarism, ideas are protected as academic product. There is no law for it, but this is the concept. So when you take somebody's ideas and you don't acknowledge from where you have taken it, you are only committing a plagiarism. There is no copyright infringement. If you understood this concept, can you just raise your hand? I can see you. So you raise your hand if you understood the concept of copyright infringement vis-a-vis plagiarism. Okay, thank you. Now, I am not reading this slide. You can read it. So can you see my slide? Yes. So you can just read it. It is only for your information. It's not only the Indian Copyright Act 1957, which is there in order to take care of copyright. In international law from Berne Convention, I did not write about Berne. That was the very first convention in 1883, the Berne Convention 1883, that talked about copyright. I am writing for your convenience that also. So you can say that from the Berne Convention of 1883, so many other conventions are there. Till the year, the last one, I think I have forgotten to write year here. Sorry, friends. So now you can see 2030. So you see from, what is happening? Yeah. Berne Convention of 1883, you can find that there are so many conventions, international conventions, which are made by the international community, adopted by the United Nations, and being administered by WIPO, World Intellectual Property Organization, Berne Convention, Rome Convention, WCT and WPPT, so 1996 Convention, Beijing Treaty, and Marrakesh Treaty to facilitate access to published works for persons who are blind. All this list I have compiled. So the rich, you can find a rich area of literature here that talks about various dimensions of copyright protection. So we should be bothered about so many provisions. It's not a neglected area. Lot of law has been worked out by the international community. So it's a very serious subject. We just cannot ignore the importance of this subject. And when especially we talk about copyright and academic institutions, I told you about academic integrity, research integrity, intellectual honesty. Can you find definition of many of these concepts that I am discussing here? No. No statute in India discussing all these aspects. But there is a regulation, a notification from the UGC, which I am going to share with you right now. So being an academician, being a teacher, you have to be conscious about your academic integrity. When you copy something recklessly, okay, you actually don't want to commit a copyright infringement, but you were irresponsible. You were careless to give the source. Aapne kabhi socha bhi nahi hai, you are doing a copyright infringement. You never wanted to do it. It was such an unintentional thing. You copied from here and there, and so many ideas of your own also was there, but you forgot to give the source of the portions that you have lifted from somewhere. It was such an unintentional thing. But still, I would say that you didn't discharge your academic integrity. So be conscious and be prudent every time. If you are using somebody's material, if you are using somebody's ideas, please and please you give acknowledgement, you give the source. So when you do a research project, when you guide your student, when you do your PhD, when you do your postdoctoral studies, when you write a book, when you write an article, always be conscious about your research integrity. Try to be original and try to create your own work. And whenever you depend on somebody else's work, as I am repeatedly telling you, you give acknowledgement. That is part of your intellectual honesty. So your aim is to produce something which is plagiarism free, wherein there will be no copyright violation. So all copyright reserved, it's a buzzword again. So you can see it everywhere now. You visit any website, there you can see. You visit any newspaper, there you can see. You visit any film, there you can see. Because the opening of the film itself will tell you all copyright reserved. So we should be alerted that this society is becoming all the more copyright conscious. So we also have to be copyright conscious. When on the one hand, you will be protecting your work under copyright law, you have to respect the other's right that they have created, that the other's right in the works that they have created. So many information you can see in this particular slide. But I would ask you to particularly go by the very first statement that I am showing you here. I don't know how many of you are aware about this. University grants promotion of academic integrity and the prevention of plagiarism in higher educational institutions regulation 2018. If you have read it already, I am happy about it. But if you haven't read it, then there is a big problem. I would say that those who haven't read this regulation should read this regulation today itself, might be immediately after my class. Or if you have a back-to-back class, I believe there will be another class on patent which will be engaged by some other expert. So then I will request you that you please don't sleep today before reading this, because it's so much important. And we don't deserve the right to be in academic community without reading this, because this gives us the code of conduct. The code of conduct as an academician who has to survive in the academic field. As a supervisor, what you have to do? As a teacher, what you have to do? As a content creator, when you write books and when you write article, what you have to do? This is what you get in this regulation. And in July 2018, it has come into force. But when I visit various institutes, I learned that various institutes haven't taken care of this regulation, and they haven't made departmental academic integrity panels and institutional academic integrity panels. This is very important. At every department level, you should have a DAIP, departmental academic integrity panel. Suppose if you have a business school, in your business school, you should have a department academic integrity panel. In your law department, you should have a departmental academic integrity panel. Then at the institute level, as an appellate authority, if you, we take the example of Geetharatnam International Business School, so you have many departments. Every department will be having departmental academic integrity panel, and then the JIPS as such will have an institutional academic integrity panel, because this panel will decide finally on the academic misconduct, whether there is a plagiarism, whether there is similarity, whether there is corporate infringement, all these aspects they will be taking care of. So this regulation is created for responsible conduct of research and responsible writing of thesis and dissertations. And for the first time, any code in India is defining what is plagiarism. There were no definition of plagiarism so far in India, and it is 2018 UGC regulation which is first time defining what is plagiarism. The practice of taking someone else's work or idea. See, look at this concept idea here. That's why I was emphasizing, and I asked you, did you follow the difference between plagiarism and corporate infringement? If corporate infringement, if copyright is not at all bothered about idea, when it is a question of plagiarism, even if you are taking the idea without quoting the source, it will become a plagiarism. Okay, so the practice of taking someone else's work or idea and passing them as one's own is plagiarism. And of course, these regulations are not strictly applicable if you are running a UG program, undergraduate course, but from PG courses, postgraduate courses, MPhils, PhDs, and then post-graduation courses, these regulations are strictly applicable. Okay, so whether you are a regular faculty, whether you are a faculty ad hoc, whether you are a faculty on contract basis, of course, you are covered under this. So you cannot say that all these are applicable only for regular employees. I am a contract employee, I am an ad hoc employee, I am a visiting faculty. No, we all are covered under this. And when you guide a particular student, suppose a student is doing dissertation under you, thesis under you, so you have certain responsibilities. As a guide, you are discharging, but let me alert you on some other facts. Earlier we used to certify this is a bona fide work done under me, but now not only that, what you have to do, you have to ask the child to do a plagiarism check which you will be overseeing, and then you have to certify that this is within the limited or this is within the permitted limit of similarity. And what is the permitted limit of similarity? I will show you another slide wherein I have calculated it So when you, I don't know how many of you are using this plagiarism softwares. Usually in India, as per the UGC recommendation, we use Urkund, we use Denigen, and there are free softwares available to do a similarity check. So you can upload your article there. And of course, when you upload, please don't put it in the repository. So you have to uncheck that. When you do a test, you know, they will ask you whether you want your document to go to repository. If it goes to the repository, what happens? Next time when you cross-check, suppose you worked on your article, it was showing 50% similarity. So you reworked it to reduce the similarity. And then again, you start using the software. Then if already you have uploaded your article in the repository, then you will get a 100% similarity. Could you appreciate this point? So you should be very careful to uncheck that box, which asks you whether you would like to give this article to the repository. Don't give any of your article to repository. So you have to uncheck it, then you do the test, and if the plagiarism test shows that it is 30% similarity, then you reduce it, because it's only 10% similarity which the 2018 regulation permits. It should not be beyond 10%. So writing an article is very easy, but bringing down the similarity is very difficult. So the regulation permits, there is another box wherein you can customize it. The 14 consecutive words together, you can ask the software to test. Because what happens otherwise, Constitution of India, Parliament of India, the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, United Nations, all this will show us plagiarized, because everywhere in the net you can find all this. So you have to say that 14 words together should be taken. So whenever you have copied the 14 words together, then only it will be showing as plagiarism. So you can see in the regulation, there are certain aspects wherein it says no plagiarism can be accepted. Even 10% similarity cannot be accepted. This is called as core area. And the underlined portions, you can take special note of abstract, summary, hypothesis, your observations, which you will be giving towards the end of your project or towards the end of your article or even towards the end of your dissertation and thesis. When you have a data analysis, the result of the analysis, the conclusion part, and when you give your recommendation, because usually in dissertations, in your articles, you give suggestions and recommendations. And all this portion can have no similarity at all. It should be your own original part. And then moving further, you can see that there are certain things that are excluded from the plagiarism test. So I am a law teacher. So usually when I write an article, I will reproduce some portions from a constitution or from a law statute or from the judgments of the court. So all these portions, you can put it in double inverted comma. And of course, then you have to give a source beneath as a footnote or endnote, whether I have taken it from the Constitution or from Copyright Act or from the Property Act, or it is from any judgment that I have taken, that I have to show. So all quoted work reproduce it, all references and bibliography, all generic terms, and the common knowledge facts. These things are not covered under this. So it is very good for us. So it is giving us some hope. Otherwise, when we say that 10% similarity only allowed, it will be a very headache for us. How it, we will confine our work only to 10% similarity. But all these things can be excluded from that similarity count. And I told you, I will show you a table wherein the limits are written. Level 0, that is the permissible limit. Similarity up to 10%. Wherein minor similarity, yes, there is no penalty. And friends, this penalty is not only for your students who write a dissertation and they plagiarized his work. It is for we all. When we write an article and if the similarity is found to be more than 10%, we also will be punished under the regulation. In my next slide, I will be talking about the various levels of punishment. So level 1, similarity above 10% but 40%. If the similarity is till 39%. Students shall be asked to submit a revised script within a stipulated time period, not exceeding 6 months. And who has to do this? As teachers, as supervisors, as department heads and deans, it's your responsibility to ensure that there is no similarity which is beyond 10%. And in level 2, if the similarity exceeds 40% and below 60%, such a student shall be debarred from submitting a revised script for a period of 1 year. And the last level is level 3, wherein similarity is above 60%. Such a student's registration for that program shall be cancelled. See how dangerous it is. You just see. So as academicians, researchers, supervisors, heads of the institutes, can we sit silently? No, then there can be action against us. So we should give awareness to the students about how much particular the UGC is in order to improve the standard of research in our country. See, it is for that they are doing this meticulous program under enhancing the standard of research, research conduct and dissertations produced in universities. If plagiarism is proved on a date later than the date of award of degree, so sometimes we may feel that, oh, I got the degree, now I am safe. Or I have plagiarized 2-3 articles and on the basis of that I got promotion as associate professor or professor, as the case may be. Now I am safe. No. There can be punishment even subsequent to that. If plagiarism is proved on a date later than the date of award of degree, his degree or credit shall be put in abeyance for a period recommended by the Institutional Academic Integrity Panel and approved by the head of the institution. This is what the regulation says. And this slide is for we all as researchers and academicians. In the article that you have published, if the similarity is below 10%, well and good. If it is beyond 10%, up to 40, then your head of the department or any person in the interview board who is assessing your work can ask you to withdraw your manuscript. Even a publisher can write to you. You have plagiarized your work and then compelled us to publish. Now you have to withdraw. If the similarity is above 40%, not only will be asked to withdraw this manuscript, you may be denied one annual increment. And you shall not be allowed to be a supervisor to any master's program, MPhil program and PhD program for a period of 2 years, even if a single manuscript is plagiarized by you. And if the similarity is above 60%, then what will be the consequence? You shall be asked to withdraw the manuscript. You shall be denied 2 successive annual increments. And you will not be a supervisor for 3 years. And apart from the 2018 UGC regulation, I would like to introduce you to some other policy measures that the international community has adopted. And of course, let me be very clear about this. These regulations and principles, they don't have any force of law. No, they are not law. They are not legislations. But as I told you, where can you find research integrity? Where can you find academic integrity? Where can you find intellectual honesty? It's in our dealing. It's in your research. It's a code of conduct. I emphasized that concept many times. It is a code of conduct. And most of the time it is unqualified. It is best practices that we have. So you can say that the Singapore Statement of Research Integrity, which was developed in the year 2010 as an outcome of the Second World Conference on Research Integrity, which was held in Singapore, wherein most of the renowned researchers across the world, across the globe, has assembled it together to do something in order to enhance the quality of research, in order to insist that researchers should be producing original research and they should restrain from copying others' research work. There they said that they have to adhere to honesty in all aspects of research, accountability in the conduct of research, be an accountable, a person who deserves accountability in the conduct of research, and professional courtesy and fairness in working with others, and also good stewardship of research on behalf of others. This is what expected from you as a researcher and as an academician. And moving further, there are other more research responsibilities. Researchers should keep clear, accurate records of all the research in ways that will allow verification and replication of their work by others. Sometimes you collect so many material when you write a dissertation, when you write a book, when you write an article. And after writing that, you may discard them. But I would suggest that you should keep it for some more time, because see, you are working in a very competitive field. Your friend might not be liking you going in promotion. So sometimes your friend may take your article, do a plagiarism test, and go to your head and say that, oh, head of the department, you see her there is a plagiarism, and you can see that it is beyond 30%, or it is beyond 40%, it is beyond 60%. So I would say that, because there are many things that can be excluded if there is a proper quotation you have given, acknowledgement you have given. So you need to keep it for some more time to prove that what is the source. Or someone say that it is misquoted. The source is misquoted. So you should have it. And all the more important when you undertake an empirical research. The data what you have collected from a questionnaire, or from observation method, or something that you have created as part of your empirical research. There also I would suggest that you should always have a clear and accurate record keeping. Then research findings. We have seen that there is a practice of manipulation of reports, especially when you conduct a research for certain organizations, certain NGOs interested it, or certain government institutions interested it. So in order to appease the institute, sometimes you may conceal certain data. You may manipulate certain analysis. No, we should not do that. We are not supposed to engage into all such things. So researchers should share data and findings openly and promptly as soon as they have had an opportunity to establish priority and ownership claims. Then I emphasized many times on publication acknowledgement. So whenever you take data from somewhere, you have to give acknowledgement. And of course, another tendency what I am telling is, especially this I am finding with the senior faculties. Senior faculty will make the junior faculties work like anything, and then they won't acknowledge you. They don't acknowledge you as a co-author. They don't acknowledge you the research work that you have done, and that is also unethical, no? If you have contributed, of course, you should be given the co-authorship. Sometimes you take help from your students. And there is a bad practice of making the students work for you, and then you don't acknowledge the contributions of the students. What is the harm if you are acknowledging the student as a co-author? If the student has authored it also, you also should have contributed, and the student has already contributed. So you acknowledge the student as the co-author, or it is you cannot give him co-authorship because that much he has not written, only he collected the material and analyzed it. So you acknowledge his research input. This is to be done. Then reporting irresponsible research practices. So though in a lighter tone, I said that your friend may go to your head of the department and say that this guy has plagiarized it. There is copyright infringement. But of course, apart from that aspect, it has got a very serious responsibility. You are responsible to report irresponsible conduct that your students, that your peers are showing in the research. If you are not having sufficient, somebody else is not having sufficient integrity, somebody has copied the thesis, somebody's article is not original, you should have the courage and guts to go to the department head, to go to the dean or go to the director as the case may be, or go to the department integrity promotional panel and tell them that this is what is happening. So then the concerned authority should also take action for misconduct. And I would say that this would enhance the research credentials of your institute. Don't think that, okay, there is a dissertation by a student where is 100% plagiarism. I have seen such occasions many times because now you can buy your dissertations by paying some amount. You go to computer shops and then you start buying, because they approach all these computer shops for printing. So always they will have a soft copy. So some unethical practice of selling the chapters and selling the dissertation. So when I went to an institute for dissertation viva, I have seen that 4 dissertations I got exactly the same, but the title were little bit different. So all the 4 dissertations were purchased. I'm so sad to share this with you, but it had happened. So as an institute head, you have all the responsibility to take actions. Don't feel that if I take responsibility, what the people will think about my institute. No, they will have more respect for your institute. And no future students studying in your institute will dare to do all these unhealthy research practices. So as a supervisor, as a head of the institute, and as a person responsible in encouraging the honesty research, integrity research practices, you should have the courage to take action for a misconduct that is happening in research and dissertations. So the best practices are data sharing. Then you have a dissemination. As I told you, many people, they don't want to share their research. What is the harm if you have done a research, you claim copyright over it, and then you share it? So dissemination is an academic responsibility, not hiding the information. You refer to the social dissemination theory that I was concentrating as the second theory when I dealt with the justification, objectives, and theories of copyright. Honest presentation of result. Transparent use of funds if it is a funded project. Your department is giving you money. A government organization is giving you a money. So there should be transparent use of funds. And the student-supervisor relationship. Supervisors are obliged to act in the student's best interest and not to take advantage of their dependence. This applies to academic results and personal matters. Look at the case. Fateh Singh Mehta versus O.P. Singhal. Here, the supervisor has published a chapter from the research scholar's thesis in the name of the supervisor. So the research scholar went to the court by telling that this is my intellectual work. I have to cooperate in the chapter that I have created. But the supervisor said, no, the work is done under my supervision. I have guided the student. The court said, nothing doing. It is the intellectual work of the student. Though you have guided and supervised the student, you don't get any right, intellectual property, over the chapters and over the articles and over the write-up that the scholar has created. So we should respect this copyright for the lifetime of the creator plus 60 years and the moral right in the work forever. Nothing less than forever. And sometimes we feel that we see that there is verbatim lifting of so many material. As I told you, paragraph by paragraph, sentence by sentence, or the entire dissertation, or the entire chapter the student has copied, or the teacher has copied. So whenever there is verbatim lifting, it is substantial portion of taking, not insubstantial. So it is a clear-cut case of copyright violation. And as I told you, the independent work concept is also available. And when you look at such a hypothetical situation also, it's practically not possible that 2 persons sat at different places and independently created the same dissertation. All chapters same, all expressions same, all words same. No. So whenever you take the excuse of independent work, this also you have to see how much it is practical. If it is a matter of writing 4 lines, poem, or taking a photography, the independent creation is possible, but otherwise it will not be verbatim same. So I will be having, I know that all are becoming tired. So I will be having 3 or 4 slides more only, then I will be winding up the class. Sometimes we feel that when a database is created, okay, you have done some research and you have created a database. There the originality is very less. In Diljit case, what happened, there were 2 juniors working in a law firm, and then they quit the law firm in order to start independent practice. So the employer, the senior lawyer, told them that you should not carry any information from my computer. But they have created a list of clients, then advices that can be given. Suppose usually in a divorce cases, what advices? You have same advices. In motor accident cases, most the legal point and advices are similar. So they have a list of points that they used to use in a particular situation. So all this data, this team has taken away from them. So the employer, the senior lawyer, went to the court. But this junior lawyer said that, you know, these were created by us when we were employed there. So the court said, during your course of employment, you have created it. So the copyright is with the senior lawyer, the employer, the firm. You cannot carry away this thing because the database created in the course of your employment is copyrightable, and the copyright is with the employer. So in the translated work, so if something is written in Hindi and you are translating it into English, for example, even if the person who written in Hindi might not be having English knowledge, that will not entitle you to do this. You have to take his permission by paying him royalty and some amount as fees. Because the right of translation is a right of the content creator. The lectures. So you take lectures in the class and a student started writing verbatim, copying it, and you are a very good teacher. The way you teach is really wonderful. So the students start recording it, or the students start writing it verbatim and then selling it as notes. No, the student cannot do that. Because you have a performance rights when you deliver the lecture in the class, even if it is not previously written somewhere. So the students cannot verbatim produce it, or students cannot sound record it and play it on a YouTube. No, they cannot do all that. Then they are violating your right. When you deliver a lecture also, you have a right. So here, I will emphasize one point. If the lectures are not pre-written, there is no copyright because there is no fixation. I think you can appreciate it now because I told you in copyright law, one requirement is that it should be fixed. Suppose a teacher is going and speaking extempore in the class. It is not fixed anywhere. There is no copyright. But still you have a performance rights. As a performer, it is your right to fix your performance. See, somebody else is fixing by writing, by recording, by video shooting. They are infringing your right. And making abridgment. Okay, so there is a book running into 1,000 pages. So you are reducing it into 100 pages for your students. You can do so only by taking permission from the content creator. And the question papers that you create, even that is copyrightable. Somebody else cannot copy that one. And of course, when you are working in a university and the university entrusts you to prepare the question paper, then of course the copyright ownership will be with the question paper because you are paid for that. It is a paid work, you know. And so in such a situation, there is copyright, but it will be with the university. And I am introducing this case, Cambridge University Press versus Baker, just to inform you that there is a shift in the judicial tendency in order to assess the doctrine of substantiality. And when you can decide and where you can decide and who will decide. Whatever portions that you have copied, whether it is substantial or not. Because if I am a poet and I have written 12 stanzas, and I may say that the one stanza is the heart and soul of my poem. And if I have taken that stanza itself, I may say that my substantial portion is taken. Because that stanza was the heart and soul of the poem. That was the crux of the poem. Because it is a qualitative analysis. The entire countries of the world practiced and followed the qualitative analysis test in order to find out the doctrine of substantiality. But in 2012, for the first time, the US court said that for the academic purpose, we can go by a quantitative analysis. So if the students have taken 10% portion, then there is no copyright infringement. And if it is more than 10%, then there is copyright infringement. Of course, in India, we haven't started using it. But I am telling you, there are countries, some countries of the world, wherein for academic purposes, they go for a quantitative analysis. And in Costa Rica also, the president of Costa Rica made an executive order permitting 10% use of the works created by anyone for academic purposes. So when we analyze the global trend, we can see that there is a shift from qualitative analysis to quantitative analysis. Okay. So we don't know whether in India also the Supreme Court or the Education Ministry or some responsible authority will follow this particular practice of finding out the corporate infringement by using quantitative analysis. But as of now, though many critics say that in US, countries like US, if they have gone for 10%, developing countries like India should go for 25%. Such intellectual arguments are going on there, but nothing in concrete as of now. And for we teachers and students, the fair dealing concept is very important, which you can find in section 52. But fair dealing is a defense in copyright infringement, as I have already told you, but it never grants you a right of reproduction of the whole material. Somebody's NDS chapter you have reproduced and then you say that, no, I have reproduced this chapter for writing a thesis. It is academic purpose. It is private study. It is research. No, you don't have that much freedom under fair use doctrine. So no substantial copying or material reproduction is allowed under fair dealing. And substantiality depends on how distinctive it is and how important it is to the overall work. So that's why I have told you, when I say that I had a chapter of 1,000 words and the 100 words that you have taken, that constitute the distinctive part of my article. Then of course, you might be committing a copyright infringement. So only reasonable excerpts are permissible, that too with acknowledgement. The larger the copying, the less fair is the dealing. I think you please try to appreciate this. This is very important. The larger the copying, the less fair is the dealing. Effect of acknowledging the source, does it make copying legal? What is your answer to this question? You have copied many things, two paragraph, three paragraph, or one page, and towards the end, you have acknowledged it. No, this is not a good practice. So when more than, there is an MLA practice, that is Modern Language Association, MLA. MLA style sheets are available. And in many disciplines, including law, many universities follow MLA style sheet for writing. And there they say, if you are copying more than four lines, friends, I am not talking about sentences, because sometimes there can be long sentences. So they say that if you are borrowing more than four lines, then that should be indented. So when you indent the material, that shows that it is not your own. So you are discrediting that you have created it. So copying so many paragraphs together, so many sentences together, and then giving a single footnote is not fair dealing. That is cunning. That is crookedness. That is not academic integrity. That is not research integrity. So if you lift more portions, then you indent it, and then you give a footnote. So what you have to do? Understand that everything is not fair use. Fair use applies only for limited purposes. And you try to create your original work. You encourage your students to create original theses and dissertations. And always you have to check the similarity by using a Turnitin or a Orkund or any useful softwares. And actually, when you go by the 2018 regulation, it is the responsibility of the academic institute to procure the software and make it available to the teachers and the students. You need not buy it. So if your university and your institute doesn't have a software like Turnitin or Orkund, because initially you have to invest money for that and annual payment you have to make. So you can say that 2018 regulation, I don't know whether head of the departments are listening to me, and I don't know whether already you have a software. If already you have a plagiarism software for similarity check, it's well and good. Otherwise, I appeal to the concerned authority that you please procure one and make it available to the faculty and the students so that they can use a licensed software and get a better result. And I am again cautioning you, please don't put your work into repositories. Don't do that. So you keep on checking the similarity so that you can reduce it to the limited extent, so below 10%. And whenever you take material, let it be one sentence also, you give acknowledgement and proper attribution of the work. And friends, how many of you know about DRM, digital rights management? Because you click photos and you put it on Facebook also. You write something and then you put it on Facebook and other social medias. So if it is your own, well and good. But somebody's message you forward, you are doing a copyright infringement. Suppose your photo is clicked by somebody else. You are not the owner of your photograph. The person who clicked the photograph is the owner. And then you share the photograph because it is your photo. No, you don't have that right. There are so many cases from various countries, including India, wherein the celebrities, I'm giving the example of celebrities, they have uploaded their photos, but not clicked by them, clicked by some professional photographers or paparazzi. And then they have gone to court by telling that my photo is uploaded by XYZ. I am not talking about privacy rights now. It is a very big legal issue. There can be privacy issues. If your photo is clicked without your permission, it affects your privacy. But suppose you are an athlete, you are a performer, so you are performing it, then you cannot say that my photo should not be clicked because the privacy right of celebrities and the public personalities are less. That is another concept. When you study constitutional law, privacy laws and IP acts together, you can appreciate this. But if the privacy issues are there, I do appreciate that. But at the same time, even if your photo but clicked by someone, you do not have any intellectual property over that. And if you share the photo, the photographer can sue you. So the cyber copyright is a totally different area which needs its own peculiar and unique understanding and appreciation in order to comprehensively understand the ambit of copyright law. So digital right management, if you write an article, if you upload something on the internet, how you can protect your digital rights? You have to give a copyright notice. Copyright is simple, you have to give. And you have to make it uneditable form so that others cannot disturb and destroy it. So some technical measures, circumvention and anti-circumvention, you might have heard about this. So some technical measures you have to adopt to secure your digital work in the digital form, in the internet. And when you read Copyright Act from Section 62, 63, 65, 65A, you will get correct information regarding DRMs, digital right management. So you always try to protect your work. As I told you, how I have protected my work, I have written copyright symbol. So when you create your slides, when you go to present the PPTs in front of your students in the class, you do this technique. Otherwise, sometimes I have seen that I prepare by taking days together, reading 10, 20 books and articles, I prepare slides for my LLM students. And very rare material, which you may not find in any other place. And the students will simply copy it, give it to somebody else, and somebody else will present to some other places as if it is their own. No. Why should I do that? Why should I work and give my work free of cost to somebody else? This is all my intellectual property. Though the information is available, I have arranged it, I have selected, I have segregated what is important to my topic. So likewise, when you take pain to create your slides, when you take pain to create your class notes, when you take pain to create your articles, you claim your intellectual property over it. You claim your copyright over it. Write copyright symbol and you protect it. No need to go to copyright office and register. And you have ample freedom to do so that also if you wish to do that. And then I would say that for the purpose of publication, because if you don't have a publication, you will not get a promotion. So you need to have 5 publications. You need to have 10 publications. Please don't go after any XYZ of the publishers. Scopus Index 1, UGC Care List 1s, only the reputed publishers. And it's not easy to publish with them. Sometimes it may take 6 months, it may take 1 year, it may take 18 months also. because it goes for review, it goes for peer review, then they send you back for revision. You have to revise it, modify it. Take that burden, take that pain, enjoy doing it. But you have a very, very credible publication. It is better to have a single publication in a Scopus Index journal than you have a 10 publication in any stupid journals. Please don't publish it anywhere like that, you know. So always go for reputed one. You download the UGC care list, what is applicable to your discipline, whether you are a law faculty, science faculty, or you are a social science faculty, what are the UGC care list one. Find out these journals and start exploring the possibilities of publication with them. What are their publication policies? So create good quality papers, take your time, and then you publish only with good publishers. And when you publish with them, especially as I told you, budding authors, they give you 10% royalty and they take away all the copyright. But I should say that don't do this. You argue with them. Only give them the first right of publication. You should try to reserve the other rights with them under Section 14. So I told you about the authorship vis-a-vis ownership issues in copyright. So, but I will tell you the other way around, how you can reserve your copyright here. So you can only give them, you negotiate and give them only the first right of publication. Remaining right can be reserved with you. And the university's role, institution's role in this entire academic research endeavor is very, very important. I should say that the university, your institute, your college, your department should always adopt a pro-faculty approach, wherein they support the faculties to undertake considerable, original, and good research. They need to have time. There should be encouragement from the authorities to undertake original research. And university itself should promote the faculties for publication. So when one faculty publishes, why can't it be put on the notice board? It is an appreciation for others also. So there can be, and there should be healthy competition. There should be healthy practices. So when one faculty publishes, others should come and congratulate. And you can also give them tips how you could publish with such a very good publisher, how they can also go about, because you also grow and you help others also grow. I think that should be the proper approach that we should adopt when we are in an academic institute, and especially when we are working in the same institute and when we are staying there as colleagues. And lastly, I would say that the University Grants Commission's Regulation 2018, you please go through if you haven't read it. And you can also read from the website the NESH guidelines. And these NESH guidelines are prepared from the Norwegian government. And you know that the Norwegia enjoys the best reputation in the world for their ethical researches. So it is one of the first countries wherein the ministry has a special wing to encourage the ethical research conduct. So the NESH guidelines, and it is almost every year getting updated, no? So the NESH guidelines, the research ethics in the social science, humanities, law, and theology can be read, because that gives you sufficient insight. Because in India, it's only the 2018 regulation what we can find at some codified regulation. There is a dearth of literature with respect to the academic integrity and intellectual honesty in India. So you read NESH guidelines. You, apart from the Singapore statement, there are other 4 more statements. So once you visit Singapore statement, you will get information regarding the other guidelines and the statement also. I did not cover all that. And I have quoted 2 articles of my own, wherein I have specifically concentrated, understanding that there is a dearth of knowledge in our country dealing with the ethical aspect in research, the copyright aspect for academicians. So one in Journal of Intellectual Property Rights, it is a Scopus Index journal. I have published this article, Copyright Issues in Legal Research and Ethics. Then another, and I think both of the articles are available online, the Ethics in Legal Research, because as I told you, I'm a law teacher, I concentrate more on legal research. This is an Indilaw Institute publication, the Legal Research Methodology. So there also this chapter I have published. And then not only this, there can be some other literature also that you can find. But these are the main things that I have used for preparing the slides. So I have taken this as the reference. And with this, I stop now. And if you have some doubts, I will be happy to take up. If I know the answer, I will tell you right now itself. And if some answers need some research or something, I can research and then I can get back to you also. May I know how will you asking the questions, whether you will be dropping in the chat box and or you will be orally presenting it, how you will be asking the questions?
Ma'am, can you hear my question?
Yes, I can hear you. Please tell me, sir.
Okay. Actually, I have some number of questions.
Yes, sir.
The first question is that you have shown in your slide that you have mentioned copyrighted this PPT. If I mention by my own with the that particular C within a bracket, is it copyrighted or I have to take a copyright registration from the authority?
No, sir, can I answer this? Then I will move to the second question.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So I have been telling this point, sir, copyright is an automatic protection. The moment you created your one slide, the copyright has come into existence. When you created the entire PPT, for the entire PPT, you have a copyright. So when you write a personal letter to your friend, so nobody will go to copyright office with a personal letter, no. There also you have a copyright. So there is no need of going for any statutory protection by a formal registration, because copyright is an automatic protection which comes into existence automatically. When a child is taken birth, all the human rights comes to him automatically. It is natural right. So by birth, you inherit all human rights. So likewise, the birth of the work in the form of a letter, in the form of a PPT, in the form of a book, in the form of a story, that grants you the copyright even without a registration. So registration is only optional. So I did not go to copyright office, but I have shown that copyright symbol because I am attributing it to myself. I am claiming my copyright. So I was giving hint to the entire faculties that when they are preparing their slides for their class also, they should claim the copyright. Why some students or somebody else copy and show that they have created it? So you should create it and you should claim it. And if that copyright symbol is not there, then of course you haven't shown that you have created. So who knows whether you have copyrighted from somewhere else also. If you know that you haven't copyrighted anywhere, you read the act, you read the article, then in your own way you prepared the scheme. Because when you heard my class, if you have heard, you know that I have arranged everything in a sequence. I have a scheme in my mind how I should address this topic in order to give a convincing and comprehensive understanding to my audience. So the scheme I have devised, the points in the slide I have devised, Of course, the explanation that I will give it's timber, but the points I have already decided. So there is no need of going to any copyright office. The moment you create, you have copyright. The birth of the work is with the copyright.
Okay. Suppose the same thing, what you have today shown as a copyrighted, the same PPT I have applied before the authority that it is my creation. Can I do this? Only I have...
No. No, sir. I have created it, you know. So when you are showing it, you cannot show that it is your copy, it is your creation. So that is a copyright violation because you are reproducing my work as your work. But if you are taking my copyright, you are studying it for writing an exam, you are studying it for writing an article, or you are referring it to take your class. And then suppose you are showing that if you are taking a printout of my copyright also, then you are showing your students, you read it, understand the points. My friend Lisa has created it. Yes, you have acknowledged me. That's it. There is no copyright violation then. But suppose you take my slides, remove my name and add your name, then that is a copyright violation. And even if it is not entire PPT, suppose you have taken my 3 slides together, my 6 slides, because I told you, again, it is a qualitative question. I have a 36 slide prepared. And suppose you are taking my 5 slides, not the entire one, and then you are using it your own, still you are committing copyright infringement because it is not the entire reproduction what will be covered by copyright infringement. Even a reproduction of a substantial aspect will be covered. So did I give answer to your question?
Yes, ma'am. I got your point. Okay. Now, my second question is, I have submitted an online registration in form, okay, for one of my book. I have registered for online registration from the copyright authority. Should I have to submit any hard copy to the authority? Can you have any answer on this?
Sir, when see, it is depending on the what you call the registration policy. Usually when you will be submitting, you can upload all the documents because online filing means you are uploading everything, but the entire book you need to hand over, sir. But if, because it is the discretion of the authority, can also be there because they say that when it is online, because certain film written, certain paintings or whatever, it is depending on the nature of the work also. So they say that when you have uploaded it, we could not actually appreciate what is it. So we need to have a physical copy, then you have to hand over one copy. Of course, if you are not going for online registration, you go offline, then definitely the physical copy should be handed over. And if you go for online registration, and depending on the nature of the work, if they demand so, then only you need to give the physical copy. Otherwise, everything you can do, everything you can upload as online. Even in the patent applications now, the government is encouraging go paperless. So they say that everything can be uploaded as e-content in the website. There is no need of going to patent office and standing in the queues. So they say that you go paperless and everything you can give there. It's only when the patent office also demands that there should be a sample of the work, a model of the work to be submitted, then you submit a physical copy. Not only with the copyright law, with all registries. Now it's what they encourage is online submissions of documents.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you. Got the point. My third question. In case of patent, there is a money or price clause there. There should be some value of, I say, commercialization value. In case of copyright, is there any such commercialization value needed? Suppose I have published a book and I say it is free of cost. Okay.
May I answer this? Yeah, I got your question. I will answer it. Yes, sir. So when you talk about the patents, we have 3 prerequisites: novelty, inventiveness, and industrial application. So the industrial application, I believe, is something that you said it should be of commercial value. There it should be something utility to the society. Yes, that is only for patent when we talk about industrial utility. With respect to copyright law, such requirement is not at all there. So in my explanation, I have told you, when you created a work, it may not be of any scholarship. It may not be of any intellectual value. It may not be of any literary merit. It may not be of any aesthetic spirit. It may not be of any entertainment content, but still you will get a copyright. Somebody else may say that your work is of no use. It is such a foolish work. Sorry to use that, but I am just explaining by using these words. So it is such a foolish work. It is such a stupid work. It is not having any meritorious scholarship in it, but still you have a copyright, because copyright is not bothered about the quality of the work, but whether it is created by an original person or not, the originality of the work. So whether I have copied it or not. But if the work is of no use, whether somebody will buy it is another question. So if I have published an article, I have written a book, and it is not giving any new information, it is not making any sense, of course nobody will buy it. I may not get any economic benefit out of it. But strictly speaking, from the copyrightability aspect, irrespective of its merit, the work can be protected. It is not at all necessary that the work should have some industrial application, or the work should have some value, or the work should have any commercial input.
Good morning, ma'am. Am I audible?
Yes, yes.
Very nice deliverables from your side, ma'am. My regards. Ma'am, my question is that generally nowadays there are co-authors, I mean two, three researchers, they jointly write the research paper. So I feel that I should go for patent, but my co-author is not interested. So in that case, can I go for patent?
Ma'am, I did not get your question, because when you write a paper, you cannot patent it. Can only be copyrighted.
I find that my paper carries some novelty. And my principal author,
Ma'am, ma'am, let me make a clarification here before you proceed with your question. So when you write an article, it can never be patented. For patent, you need a concrete invention. Only inventions can be patented in the form of something, a process patent or a product patent. There should be invention. So the subject matter of patent is invention. And the subject matter of copyright is a work in the form of an article, in the form of a novel, in the form of a book, etc. So if you have invented something in the form of a concrete shape, only then you can go for patenting, and there can be co-inventors. It can be 3 inventors, it can be 4 inventors, it can be 5 inventors. And even if you're copying the paper that you are talking about is having some novel idea, it will never entitle to have a patent, understand, until you have a concrete invention in your hand.
Thank you so much, ma'am. My second question. Ma'am, please give little insight on self-plagiarism. Like, I have to quote my paper only. So how
we should quote? I got it. I will explain, ma'am. So plagiarism can be of different types. I would have loved to discuss it in detail if time had permitted me. I did not get into all that the details of plagiarism, but plagiarism can be of different types. So when we talk about the self-plagiarism, so I have written an article somewhere, and then by making cosmetic changes, I am changing the title, I am taking the subheadings, 2-3 lines, I am adding 2-3 lines, I am removing, and I am making a second article. Because I need, as I told you, when we are in academics, we need to produce articles, and we need to get promotions also. So sometimes some researchers do all this technique, and this is self-plagiarism. When you make some cosmetic changes and making another article. And another type of self-plagiarism is that, okay, I have written a thesis somewhere, then I am converting one chapter into an article, without acknowledging the fact that it is my thesis. Okay. So whenever I am producing something from my own work, I have it to acknowledge it, because my paper is published somewhere, so the system has to copyright. So I would say that Lisa P. Hugo, Journal of Indo Institute, the title of article, the year, date number. Lisa P. Hugo, Journal of Intellectual Property, right? Or Lisa P. Hugo, the chapter in a particular book. Even if it is by you, I have to acknowledge it. The publication, the book name, the journal name, the year, the page number, everything I need to do. So self-reporting and self-publicity you can do, and you have to. Otherwise, it is a self. But when you acknowledge yourself, then there is no problem. I can say that there is no problem. that you give but that article everywhere you acknowledge you, what does it mean? Your research was very bad. You didn't read anything apart what you have written. Okay, so there should be rich footnotes wherein you refer to other authors also, other materials also. But if you are referring to your own article, please, you have to acknowledge it. Not only that your paper, but where it got published, who has published it with the full intimation, you have to do.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
My pleasure. Any more questions?
Good afternoon, everyone. It was a wonderful session. I was there. So I thank Professor Lisa for being such a wonderful person and sharing her thoughts. It was like I appreciate the way she had sensitized about copyright, about plagiarism, about UGC policy, which she was talking about. Of course, every academician should know that UGC policy, like, you know, if you are doing plagiarism, it can affect your career. We had earlier shared this policy with all faculty members, if faculty members remember, or I think we can share again that policy so that they can you can go through it and you should be aware that what is the UGC policy about it. And about the plagiarism check, we have a software in our library. And that is a plagiarism checker X. That is the software we have. So, of course, as a policy, whenever papers are submitted for, we have some incentive policy for the publications. So whenever the faculty submits, it goes through a committee and they review the papers and they do the plagiarism check. And that is there. And of course, for our journal, like we have a law journal, which we are following the ILI pattern in that. And that there also, whenever we get the papers, that is plagiarism check is done. In the management journal also, plagiarism check is done. So in that way, to some extent, we are sensitive to the plagiarism issue. And we want our faculty, of course, we had shared the UGC policy like you have deliberated on them. And of course, I appreciate like you have sensitized them about the publication also. So we have a publication policy for incentive like Scopus, UGC CARE. In case they are publishing in UGC CARE, there is some incentive. In case they are doing for Scopus and international journal, there is an incentive in that. And I also appreciate the question answer session, which was done in a wonderful way. The questions were asked, even like you had mentioned about the copyright of your slides. So that was a curious to know how you have mentioned it. So you have answered wonderfully well. And of course, we look for more opportunities because last time you had come physically and on the similar topic, and we had done it on one symposium on IPR. So I'm thankful to you, and I'm also thankful to the participants for being there, and they must have got a great takeaway from this session. So thank you, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for the kind words, and it was my privilege to be here. And I always like coming to GIPS and meeting you all in person, but because of COVID and all, I could not do this time. Yeah, but I'm happy right. That you remember me. When you arranged the program, you remembered me. So yeah. Thank you so much for that you have shown. It's always a pleasure to come and meet you and share my views with your faculty, sir. I'm happy.
So nice. So nice. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
So I can leave, sir.
Manisha, anything else? Okay.
So Anoop Ghosh sir, with your permission, may I sign off?
Yes ma'am.
Thank you everyone. Have a good day. Bye.